All right, let's now talk about GPT version 2. So before we talked about GPT version 1, just to recap, GPT stands for Generative Pre-trained Transformer. And these are models developed by OpenAI Research. And one fundamental aspect about them is that they are unidirectional models, trained to predict the next word in a sentence or in a sequence, in contrast to the BERT model, which has this bidirectional language modeling approach. So before we talked about GPT version 1, which was a model consisting of 110 parameters, came out in 2018. Now we are going to talk about the second version, which came out only 1 year later. It has now 1.5 billion parameters, substantially larger, more than 10 times larger. And yeah, we are not going to cover all the nitty-gritty details about this model, but if you are interested, here's a link to the original paper if you want to learn more after this video. Okay, so also again, just to recap the GPT version 1 architecture. So GPT version 1, there was this transformer decoder with 12 transformer blocks, and this was first pre-trained. They had this text prediction where they were predicting the next word in the sequence. And then they had, as a second step, the fine-tuning to the downstream tasks. And here were some examples like classification, entailment, similarity, and multiple choice. So the fine-tuning happened on labeled datasets, where the pre-training was on large unlabeled datasets. Now, why am I recapping this? Because GPT version 2 made a big change to that procedure. So the key concepts behind GPT version 2 are, first of all, that it is similar to GPT 1 in the sense that it's also unidirectional. So the pre-training is still next word prediction or next token prediction. However, compared to GPT version 1, the version 2 model is significantly larger, and the argument is the larger the better. They had some plots also, I will show you that later, that they did experiments with smaller and larger models, and they saw the larger the number of parameters, the better the performance. And also with the data set, the argument was a larger data set will help with the model performance. So the key difference, though, instead of making just things larger, is that now they don't do any fine-tuning. They use something called zero-shot transfer. It's kind of related, I would say, somewhat related to zero-shot learning. It's not quite the same. So here it's really about providing some context together with the input to perform the task. I will also show you an example later, how that looks like. But one thing to highlight here really is that they got rid of the fine-tuning. So the architecture itself, it's overall similar to GPT version 1. Of course, it's bigger, but it's still based on the original transformer decoder. They did some small rearranging of the layer norm and residual layers, but these are minor implementation details, I would say. They increased also the vocabulary size, almost twice the size, but another detail. They doubled the context size, though. I mean, from 512 input tokens now to 1024, so they can capture more context. And I think it's also kind of useful when you think about the fact, I will show you an example, when you have to provide the task together with the input, like the zero-shot transfer. So I think it's also why they made the context size bigger. Overall, these changes resulted in a model of consisting of 1.5 billion parameters compared to the original model, which was already large, with 110 million parameters. So the data set they used, I mentioned also they made the data set larger. So they had this so-called web text data set consisting of millions of web pages. And they also said improving the quality was important. So how did they improve the quality? So these web pages were based on Reddit posts, so they collected or focused on Reddit posts with karma of 3 or more. So they were saying, okay, this is like a minimum requirement for linking to a reasonable website, that it's not like a garbage post. But then also many of these had to duplicate, so they did some deduplication and also some other website preprocessing, cleaning, and so forth. So overall they got 45 million links to websites from Reddit, and then after pre-processing and cleaning, they had 8 million documents, amounting to 40 gigabytes of text. Here's an example of this zero-shot task transfer that I mentioned before. So in contrast to GPT version 1, there's no specific instruction or rearranging for the specific task. So what I showed you earlier was that they had to rearrange certain things here and did the fine-tuning. Now they don't have any fine-tuning in something like that. However, I couldn't find a very concrete example of that. I was honestly a little bit unsure of how that looked like. I found under the Hugging Face repository an example, though, of zero-shot topic classification. So Hugging Face is a company specializing in language models, and specifically transformer-based language models. And I guess I will show you an example also, like of a BERT model in the coding examples, as the last video. But here, so they had this nice online interface for playing around with zero-shot topic classification. So you could essentially provide some input, and then you provide your own labels. So these are labels the model necessarily doesn't have seen before, right? Because it's trained just to do the next word prediction. But then after that, you provide possible topics separated by commas here. So I just provided some. So this was my own question. I just asked a random question: what is the color of grass? And then I provided possible labels: green, red, blue, nothing, pink, and purple. And it got it correct here. So yeah, it was kind of cool. All right. So here are some results from the paper on the size of the model. So they saw, essentially, you can see in all four plots in the top, you can see on the x-axis, so on the y-axis are some evaluation criteria, I think for all of them, the larger the better. And you can see on the x-axis the number of parameters for the language models, and this blue line is their GPT model, and you can see that in all cases it goes up here, basically saying that more parameters is kind of better. You can also see, though, I mean, these are for different tasks: reading comprehension, translation, summarization, and question answering. They're not reaching the performance of other methods, so other methods are better at certain tasks here. But this is also not necessarily the point, I would say. So not always outperforming other methods. It was really just showing that these methods automatically learn how to understand text even without the fine tuning, which was actually, I would say, quite impressive. So here are some more tasks, and in this case they actually performed pretty well. So I think in bold here, the bold ones are their performances, and you can see here they outperform other tasks here except this one task. And I think here the argument was that in this 1BW task, the sentences were shuffled. So there was a sentence level shuffling in this data set. So it's an existing data set. And this kind of defeats the purpose of having a large context as input, because one of the points is that the model can take context into consideration, a transformer, right? But if you shuffle the sentences, you destroy that context. So that is maybe one possible explanation why the language models really didn't outperform other models here. Okay. This was GPT version 2, a short video, and then another short video on GPT version 3.